away, Dobie.
Ta-da, and welcome to Joseph's Model Railway and Toy Room. Thank you so much for joining me. As always, a bit of housekeeping. You don't need to like, follow, or subscribe. I just put the videos out where I can and have a jolly good time doing so. So what are we up to today? Well, I'm a victim of my own genius at the moment. It looks as though we will be able to get our slight oil refinery or petroleum depot, if you like, happening in the corner. However, I do need to order some additional track work for it to happen, and I'm waiting on that coming in. I've also put in several orders regarding ballast and various types of paint and things like that, and including some very special pieces I'm waiting for that I have been told could be anywhere between 4 to 6 months in transit. So as a result, we need to not waste our time and carry on with some other projects. As you all know, the focus, of course, is to get the base track work all done before Christmas time, 2022, so we can at least see a train go around in a loop. I'm convinced the wiring won't be done, the ballast won't be completely laid, but at least we've got a little bit of functionality and we're pushing in the right direction. So while we're waiting to carry on with the rest of the track building, and I have completed now the feature section with all the track being laid now, we'll carry on now while we're waiting on those particular pieces, and we're going to flip over to the other side where I'd left a little section of derelict rail. We're going to spend a moment now, and I'll shoot this over several weeks as parts and materials become available for what I'm doing. This is certainly a section of track that we don't need to wait on anything else for, since it's not connected to the main section of the layout. And perhaps in time we may have some old disused rusty wagons and or some graffiti styled old locomotive that was just left to rust. I don't know. But the important thing is we do need to get that track work looking good. And there's a few steps I need to do over time to make it look like that. So join me now. And let's go through the process together. So as you can see where those Coca-Cola soda cans are located, that is where we're just going to do a little bit of trickery, where we're still going to have the two tracks wrapping around for the loop. But I've got a little bit of room that I should be able to fit two lines down for our storage with our tankers, possibly with a main storage tank and or siding in this vicinity over here, and hopefully some overhead pipe work for where the tankers will be. If we swing around now, you can see how the feature section has now been laid, and I'm very happy with what we've achieved here so far. And where you can see that coach and the track stops, and of course is where we're going to have our roadway, which is the first piece of landscaping I'm going to focus on and may well be happening before you see this video. And of course, there you can now see this derelict section of cork where we're now going to lay some track that we're going to weather particularly well, because this is when it would have primarily have been in the steam era and is now a disused line. So the ballast will look somewhat different from what we're seeing over here. Again, the era of this particular layout I'm probably working on is anywhere toward the late 40s, albeit 50s around to the early 90s is pretty much what we're going to see. There's a lot of playfulness to be had. And while for the most part, we're going to see a lot of diesels, I still want to see some steam locomotives running upon the layout like anyone would. And whether or not that's something that you still did see perhaps there in the late 50s. More importantly, I suppose it's the idea that we still see now on some popular main lines today, where we certainly bring out some of our favorite steam locomotives and they're run in some sort of ceremony or nostalgic run day. And that's exactly what I want to see here, because I've got something very special planned for my model railway community that would be happening for Christmas time, and we will come back to that in many, many later videos. As discussed in earlier videos, this is going to be our feature road section that we're working on. And this is what would have been the main line back in the days before the rail network boffins decided we need to put in new infrastructure for a two-line capacity. And as a result, what I've done for added interest, since this road is going to be cut anyway, I've actually added a few extra layers of cork here to raise this section of track bed up to really give it that nice type of where it may have been going off into that coastal section. Remember, I do have the curved viaduct over in the corner, which we're going to be working on with that sort of salt type of situation, a boat ramp, albeit. So even though we're going to be seeing some sort of disused tracks a bit with some sleepers that have become misconfigured and where they've decided to cut it, this still needs to remain true to its original connection in its alignment. So yes, we're going to bring our laser back out and we're going to make sure when we put the track down, it looks smooth. I guess the other key thing on this feature is there will be no running trains on here. So I don't think we're actually going to use the traditional track joiners. I'm going to just literally do my best to keep the track perfectly lined up so it looks as naturally as possible. And we're going to spend a bit of time weathering this track, more so than the rest of the layout, which I'm really not too fussed about. So we're really going to add some detail here. The other thing about lifting that cork up particularly was about, because I've got the edge of the cabinet work here, we want to try and lift it up to that eye level to look quite smooth. So further up the line, apart from being covered in vegetation that will exist, the line will carry on and come down to the end here. And this is where it'll sort of taper off and fall away. Now, the key thing I wanted to point out is this is where you would have seen some sort of erosion and that starting to happen to where the track would have been cut off and sort of left to die, so to speak. Now, I don't know if the close-up will show what I've done, but on that top layer of cork, I literally just took a few offcuts and snipped it into shape. So it still seems right where the track was going to be sitting, but you can see where we literally have the weather that's eroded the ballast away and it's sort of just gone a little bit nasty. So that's kind of the plan of attack we're working for. So unlike the other side where we're literally just going to come along and start ballasting, I thought what we might do to kick all this off is I'm actually going to lay some brown paint over this section at the moment, especially because it's going to fill in the little areas where some of the ballast, since we'll be using some darker stuff, might look wrong should it start to crumble away in the future. Remember, with the steam, you will also notice as well with that top piece of cork that I did, I actually just cut it about a centimeter thinner than the bottom bit, so it gives me an extra bit of a step for that nice defined shoulder. Nothing fancy about this, some cheap, cheerful brown paint that my wife had left over from a job. It's all we need. I'm just adding a few dabs of water to it just to thin it out a little bit. Okay, so we'll leave this to dry overnight and pick it up again tomorrow. So here we are as we work on what is the disused line, but we also need to sort this out. So we have that modular hillside that we've done, and you can see I've just made a few little rudimentary marks with the black marker there for what will be basically be a roadside ditch, not really with any water. It'll be pretty dried out, so to speak, but obviously the way to head over to the boat ramp for the cars will probably just notch a little bit out what would appear to be a bit of a water runoff where the water course may be traveling through, maybe even carry it this way. Where this fence line, we're actually going to split into two sections, which would, apart from where the cows are roaming fine here, and this section has just been harvested, this half here will look like it needs harvesting. So that's our plan of attack. Let's get drilling away and hope it all works out. Now, the thickness that we're going down to, the thickness of this ply, remember, is what we have here. So we're basically looking basically only to scalp and get in at about half a fingernail's length into there. Try not to disturb the bottom. As I said, it worked well on the other side. This could be a little bit shallower because we're gonna go wider, but let's see what happens. Now I'm sure there's a Dremel attachment that would work much better and something that won't damage my drill, but here we are. Taking our coarse sanding block at the moment. I wasn't really going to come back and do it. I'd made a minor one, but I'm so glad that I did, because I think that's really what we need, is that beautiful separation that we see usually between the roadside and the rail. Plan of attack. We're going to paint this down. Swampland green is actually what we're using, even though it's a brown. This has been watered down with 50% water in it, just to thin it out. And once we've laid it down, a quick sprinkling of some of our fine dirt at the moment. Don't worry too much about where the transition happens. We'll tidy them up later. And don't worry too much. It's only a light dusting of the sand, just for a little bit of texture. And we're just going to use the drying of the paint to grab it. Now, this paint dries very quickly, especially when it's soaking into something like this. We may actually just do a base coat and come back and do a second coat and do the sand, just because I'm looking at it and it's an exceptionally warm and windy day today. Because that's so watered down, I am going to drop some dirt straight on top of it, and we'll see how we go. That if we build up much more paint, it's what's going to happen on the other side. I lose the depth, and then I had to re-go again. So let us get our dirt. Remember, this has been sifted down to a fine grade, or as fine as I like to use here. Put a stocking over it. Orange stocking, I think it was from Halloween last year. I spotted it in a cheap shop. I said they'll do just nicely. This is really just to give texture and a bit of a bleed into it. Unlike what we're doing on the other side with the oil refiner, I painted grey and I'm doing something different. This is the cheap, easy way to get out of it when you're doing the countryside. Real dirt from the garden. You can't beat the real thing when you're modelling. Some 2 years ago we were doing this disused section. Of course, since then we've got our roadside attraction and the roadside Christmas tree and station all going up this side, and of course you'll recall we had our cattle grate, and not much else happened for quite some time, but here we are. So we've got our ballast that's going down. We're still just waiting for the rest of this to dry as we speak, and we're starting to link together the forest section and the coastal scene, which I will need to finish both sections to create the segue. As a result, we can see where we get that overspill of the sort of salty sea sand coming over across to here, and we'll weather that accordingly. But the disused track, this has been down for a long, long time, for a line that once used to exist. So we'll blend those together. But I just wanted to briefly talk. Now we're going to do our ballast for this disused section of track. It's not wired up, it's not doing anything. It's just going to be a rusted line that's going away. And I thought what we might do in this process is we'll use a different ballast, because obviously this is the current stuff we'd be seeing, certainly as by the 80s into the 90s, and currently we're using this type of grey blend, but of course back then it isn't. So we're probably going to come along with our Woodland Scenics brown. I think I might even, just for a touch of colour, add a few extra flecks of iron ore perhaps to it, and also we will sprinkle on a little bit of our coal cinders as well, remembering that this would have been a very heavily used steam train line. And of course, that's what we're going to do. And we can finally now also add a bit of static grass to carry on. So we're gonna carry on finishing this scene and flick you straight back to the time lapse. We are now commencing some ballasting on our disused section of track. This is strictly a static display only. The track itself is not wired up.
It is just meant to look like a disused, rundown section of an old branch line. Why am I talking in this hushed tone? Well, this is really quite a feature, and I really, really want the eye to be drawn in on this one. But let's make a couple of quick points. Parts of the section of the track need to look washed away, so I cut some of the cork underlay out that will represent a bit of a washout happening. The other thing is, to future Josef watching, for the next layout, I would prefer to lay ballast down before I do the track. If we just zip over to some footage here, you'll see how I have done the ballasting on the rest of the layout, the express style, they call it. We'll come back and discuss that on another video. But as you can see, the sleepers tend to sort of get buried into the scenery, whereas they should be sitting above it. That's why this will look a lot more natural. Now, in retrospect, I would have been better purchasing a higher grade type of track where the sleeper spacing was more accurate. But if you look very closely and we come down just a fraction, you'll notice you can still see the underneath plastic that joins up the sleepers. And in retrospect, that should have been cut away to give you better details. So this is a top tip for those of you who are doing it. Now, the second thing is, rather than using our ballast dispensing hopper that most of us use, and it's certainly what I've been using on the main line, that we pop the ballast in and drag it along to give us an even coverage. Again, talking in a future video, the challenges that come along with these devices, we're going step by step using just a teaspoon. So much so, it gives me complete and utter control. And when it comes time for pushing the ballast between the sleepers, we're going to do it just using a small brush. We don't want to overdo it. And I think, as you can see, and we carry on, that looks a whole lot more realistic than just having clumps of it that are building up, certainly as you can see in the background. So of course it's going to take a lot longer, but this is the process, since this is going to be a key feature point to look at. The other thing is, regarding that plastic, we're not going to worry too much, because if we drop the camera down now to the eye level, as we come down, here's our cabinet work. So by the time you come in on the angle to look down there, you can't notice it, because the cabinet work, thankfully, will start to frame it out. That's just a blessing in disguise. To be fair, I would have preferred to have used a better quality track that looked a little more realistic, but we will carry on. Just bring you in close for a minute here. A little touch I like to do, as you can see, a blob of glue just down here to hold our guardrails in, and that works quite well. And I took a little bit of a pastel. I didn't have a much of a gray one, so the one I used, you can see it's not much of a difference between the landform there. It's not too bad, but it would look nicer if we had a bit more of a concrete footing that it was cemented in with. So that's where I love these weathering powders. I got a pack of four from DCC Concepts. We obviously have, it comes with a red rust, a yellow clay,
a black one, and of course a mid-grey. Any grey would do, but this is the one we've got. Remembering this stuff does go a long way, so just be careful with it. I usually like to decant off from the lid with what I need when it's something minor on a building or something, but on here we can be just a fraction more jealous, so we get a bit on the brush. We want to be a little careful because we don't want to get too much up and around the sides. We're just going to dust it on just around the bottom here. The good thing as well is if you end up with a few of the little granules, don't worry about trying to break them down because it does give that more bit of a rougher texture. They're not always using the finest quality concrete. And half the time with some of this stuff, it's just a ready mix bag that they're mixing up on site. Bit of water and away you go. But I think it just adds that bit more detail to the scene as required. You don't actually have to do anything further to lock this down, but I certainly would drop just a little bit of scenic cement over it. You really won't need much. Don't panic, it's never as bad as it looks. And then we'll just let that dry. Okay, so we're trying to simulate what would basically be a bit of a wheat field here that still needs to be harvested. And the kit that we're using in this particular application is from BUSCH here, and it is this wheat field. And this is basically the result you can see you can do by lining it up. It's exceptionally simple, as you can see. We have a series of these sections on a sprue. They recommend you paint the bottom section in a dab of brown paint, and then you just glue them, cut them out, and then glue them into section to form some nice rows. Many sprues later, and here's what we have. But I wanted to stop you here to give you some top advice where I think there might be a better way to do this. So first of all, here was one of the sprues that we had. And you've got to be careful when you're doing the painting of the bottom because you can easily accidentally do the previous layer and then paint the tops as well. That one actually wasn't a bad one, but you can see where I've clipped it there. Look, it's not too bad. You really do need to prime the bottom. The paint does a lot of trouble sticking, so I'm thinking this isn't a good way to go. So here's my top tip for getting around it. What you'll do is cut a series of these out. Then, taking some glue, just put a drop here, here, and at the end. And then you cut the other one out and sit them in. And that's exactly what we've got here. If you look carefully, you'll see I actually have two rows that have been put together. And I'm even going to go as far as to say, don't worry about doing this painting step. As you can see where I came in, you can probably see here's some brown here actually that has come in that the brush hit. Too many problems and it can get bumped. So yes, we want to clump them together. I reckon if I did it three, even four times and kept stacking them onto each other using this type of glue, this is a much, much better result. Now, again, let's skip the painting process and I'm going to show you what we do. I leave the dry 24 hour. I leave the glue on for 24 hours to dry. You definitely don't have to do that. I'm going to cut it out. And of course, the quick way in this application is to do one side at a time. Remember, because I've glued this together, these are twice the depth. So to be fair, these are probably not the best cutters for doing this. Probably end up making more of a mess, actually. As you can see, because I had an uneven texture, because I wasn't sure what was going to happen here, they recommend putting them down and then gluing them up against each other. But as you can see, some are leaning to the left, some are leaning to the right, so not good. So doing it this other way means they're all perfectly in a nice straight series of rows. But this is going to be the final row we're doing where we've double stacked them, and we're going to slide them in. So what we're just going to do, we're just going to put a bead of PVA glue down, put them into place, and then I'm going to share with you a magical tip, I think. Now, you would have seen before that I was using a series of pins. Again, that's just to hold it in place, and the surface is uneven. Why did I bead so much PVA down? Is basically because we're also using it to sort of level it up and create a bit of a shoulder for what we're up to here. So it looks like we actually have a cultivated field. Now this thick bead of glue is here for a reason. One, it's helping it stand up without me needing any pins, and two, it helps give us a little bit of a slope to where this is going to end. Still, that isn't quite the magic ingredient. Let me show that with you now. Even when these have been painted brown, if you actually can look down, you may just see it doesn't always get into the middle where it needs to be. This one actually is one of the more better ones, but it doesn't always get down there. But even when it does, that brown paint really doesn't look good. So the trick is, what I find is we take some of our fine mixed up dirt, and because I need it to look a little more healthier, the soil, and a little more agricultural, we've just also mixed in a couple of series of the brown pastels in there, really to give it that nice, rich, earthy kind of texture. Sort of soil you can expect to see if you're traveling through Isis or Gingin here in Queensland. Very fertile ground that's used for a lot of the crops that we eat. But here's how we're going to apply it. We can't just sprinkle it on now. Well, we certainly could do with the PVA. However, the problem is it's not going to get where it needs to get. And of course, as you know, the PVA will dry into an almost rubbery plastic type of finish. So what we're going to actually do is use our 50-50 PVA. Remember, 50% PVA, 50% water, some dishwashing drips, dishwashing liquid. Then we're going to bleed some in, and then we're going to dust this in. And you'll find I've got some. We need to change the camera again, but the angle I'm looking at for what has been done has worked really well. And the need for painting this, you can throw that in the bin. That's unnecessary. Just a little bit of wet water to help things along with this one. And then we'll take our scenic cement with the eyedropper and just run it down the bottom here. Don't worry about any of the overrun, that's probably a good thing. Let's take it now. Stocking over the top, of course, as always. And we'll just dust it in. And there we go. That's pretty much what we do. We're going to leave this to dry before we come along and tickle it with the vacuum. But if we come in looking at the top now, you can see the result we're getting looks a lot better. So much so that if we remember, this is only on a small part of the scene, so it's not looking all too bad. I still may build that edge up a little bit more. But again, we need to work in layers on this, so we'll certainly let it dry and clean it up accordingly. But that's the approach we've used, and it's not too bad. And if we just move on to the other side of our drainage, you'll see a section that we're basically just trying to create as what would look like a section that has just been harvested. To be fair, I didn't make it. It's just one of these pre-bought ones, and it's probably just a front door mat that's been cut up. That generally is what most people do. But I think it just gives a nice sort of overall appearance with what we're doing here.
Just before we conclude this video, I just want to point this tree out because in the conclusion, which I've already filmed, we didn't have this tree. We had a different one. But I think putting in a bigger tree really does frame this off a little bit better. We are going to come back and do some additional work. I need to clean up where the tree is. But for the most part, this is pretty much what we've got at the moment with the disused section. And I think there's plenty of room for improvement and a lot we can be doing. But at least it gives us a little something to look at as the trains will pass by. That's a wrap. Ta-da! One semi-completed, disused section of train line. Look, the video is already far too long as it is. I'll probably come back with you a little later on. I did want to do a bit more with some powder and stuff like that, just weathering this kind of area and just giving it a bit more of a seamless join. But in my head, this is pretty much how I wanted it to be. The only thing that's not quite right is just down here, while I'm happy with how the track did come off, and that is right in my head, just the way the scenery and maybe some almost mangroves or something are growing across the back section of the track. But we can come back and look at that. We've got another surprise coming up for you shortly to do with how we're creating our segue to the coastal scene. So stay tuned for that. But as you can see probably from the previous videos, we obviously did have our cattle grate crossing that I'm 100% happy with how that did turn out. I also have recently just put those railway signs, the crossing signs we worked on earlier, they're finally in place now, and a street lamp in the distance you can see. But the focus has always been this, and this is one of the feature sections you are going to come down and see, and I really think it's good. We've got this locomotive that's pretty much just left to just let Mother Nature take over. Again, I did want to come back a bit more, a bit of greenery around it or something. And also we have what would be a grain or a wheat field or something that's growing along here. Again, this section hasn't been harvested, and behind me, this section has been. We can see the differentiation in height and indeed in color, of which this stuff in the back is probably just the front doormat you can buy from your local hardware shop and just cut up. Look, I don't know. I did purchase it from someone. Who knows what they did. But the whole scene, we've got our cows here having a bit of a sip with the stormwater runoff, particularly in the back here, which we've now got our road that links, where we turn off from the sealed road and make our way down to the boat ramp. The water has been poured, that's why it's covered up in the back section. 85% of all wiring is now complete under the board, just waiting on a couple of distribution blocks. And further projects are 99% complete, all waiting for one bit here or there. So that's what has delayed some of these videos. But this scene is now complete. So girls and boys, ladies and gentlemen, as always, thank you so much for your patience in this epic video. Thank you so much, as always, for joining me. And I look forward to seeing you next one. Stay safe. Toodles.